Good morning. Torricelli's theorem says the speed of an ideal fluid flowing out of a small spigot from a very large reservoir equals the square root of 2 times gravitational field strength times the vertical height the top of the fluid is above the spigot. Let's demonstrate Torricelli's theorem using a rain barrel. This rain barrel normally collects water which falls on the roof of our garage.
Flippin' physics!
Today I have placed it on several cement blocks to elevate the spigot above the ground. Bo, please determine the speed at which the water will flow out of the spigot.
That is Torricelli's theorem, right?
Yes.
So we already have it, right?
Sure, but it is not on our equation sheet, so we need to derive it.
We do not like memorization. We understand physics much better when we understand where equations come from.
Okay, then how about you derive it?
Absolutely. Bernoulli's equation, which is on the equation sheet, states that pressure at point 1 plus 1 half times the fluid density times the speed at point 1 squared plus fluid density times gravitational field strength times the vertical height of point 1 above the horizontal zero line equals... That same thing, only change all the 1 subscripts to 2s. Let's identify point 1 at the top of the fluid, point 2 at the end of the spigot, and the horizontal zero line at the center of the spigot, where point 2 is. Both points 1 and 2 are open to the atmosphere, so they are both equal to atmospheric pressure and cancel one another out. And because the cross-sectional area at point 1 is much, much larger than the cross-sectional area at point 2, we can assume the speed of the fluid at point 1 is approximately equal to 0. And let's identify the height of point 1 above the horizontal zero line as h1. And we know point 2 is at the horizontal zero line, so the vertical height of point 2 is 0. All we are left with is fluid density equals gravitational field strength times height 1 equals 1 half times fluid density times speed at point 2 squared. And
everybody brought fluid density to the party.
Everybody brought mass.
And we can solve for the speed at point 2. It equals the square root of 2 times gravitational field strength times height of point 1.
Well done. Now, we will not be able to directly measure the speed of the water flowing out of the spigot. However, because the water will be in projectile motion, we will be able to predict how far the water will go in the x direction while it is in projectile motion. But first, notice the spigot is not horizontal. It would be much easier to do the projectile motion math if that spigot were horizontal. So I will place a couple of rocks under the rain barrel to make the spigot horizontal. Also, I have put a yellow hose in the barrel to add water to the barrel as water flows out of the spigot. There is also a drain pipe on the side of the rain barrel. When I turn on the water to the hose, the barrel will fill until water flows out of the drain pipe. At that point, I will be able to open the spigot. Water will flow into the rain barrel through the hose and flow out of the rain barrel through the spigot and the drain pipe simultaneously. Because this reservoir is not actually very large, using the hose to add water to the reservoir keeps the height of the top of the water in the barrel constant. But before we do all that, let's take measurements and do the calculations. First off, the vertical height of the drain pipe above the spigot is 0.421 meters. So we can use Torricelli's theorem, which we derived, to determine the speed of the water coming out of the spigot, the speed at point 2. It equals the square root of 2 times 9.81 times 0.421, or 2.8740 meters per second. Now, let's actually split this problem into two parts. Let's call part A the part we just did, the part in the rain barrel, and let's call part B the projectile motion part of this problem. In other words, the speed we just determined is the final speed of part A, and it is the initial speed in the x direction for part B. It's the initial speed in the x direction for projectile motion. With regards to projectile motion, I measured the height of the spigot above the ground, let's call it height B, to be 0.668 meters. Bo, please use what we know about projectile motion in the y direction to determine how long it will take for the water to fall to the ground from the spigot.
Sure. Things we know for part B in the y direction. Well, because you made the spigot horizontal, the initial velocity of the water in part B is completely horizontal, and that makes the initial velocity in the y direction for part B zero. The displacement in the y direction for part B is the negative of height B. It's negative because the water is displaced downward. Because the water is in free fall, the acceleration in the y direction for part B is the negative of the acceleration due to gravity, little g. And we are solving for change in time for part B, so that equals question mark. Because the acceleration in the y direction is constant, we can use the uniformly accelerated motion equation. Displacement in the y direction for part B equals the initial velocity in the y direction for part B times change in time for part B plus 1/2 times acceleration in the y direction for part B times change in time for part B squared. The initial velocity in the y direction for part B is zero, so that term cancels out of the equation. And solving for change in time for part B gives us that change in time for part B equals the square root of the quantity 2 times displacement in the y direction for part B, all divided by the acceleration in the y direction for part B. We can substitute the negative of height B in for displacement in the y direction in part B, and the negative of the acceleration due to gravity for the acceleration in the y direction for part B. The negatives cancel out, and we can substitute in our numbers to get change in time for part B equals the square root of the quantity 2 times 0.668 over 9.81, or 0.36904 seconds.
Well done, Bo. Bobby, please solve for the predicted displacement of the water in the x direction for part B.
Okay, things we know in the x direction for part B are the change in time for part B is a scalar, so it is independent of direction. So we know we can use the change in time for part B, 0.36904 seconds, in the x direction. And we already determined the initial velocity in the x direction for part B. It is 2.8740 meters per second. We used Torricelli's theorem to find that, which we derived.
Yeah.
In the x direction in projectile motion, we know the velocity is constant, so we can use the equation velocity in the x direction for part B equals the displacement in the x direction for part B divided by the change in time for part B. We can rearrange that to get the displacement in the x direction for part B equals the velocity in the x direction for part B times the change in time for part B. Substituting in numbers gives us the displacement in the x direction for part B equals 2.8740 times 0.36904 or 1.0606 or 1.06 meters with 3 sig figs.
Thank you, Bobby. In our yard, I found a little rubber ducky left over from my daughter's graduation party just over a year ago, so I will place that little rubber ducky a distance of 1.06 meters in the x direction to the right of the spigot, the end of the spigot. Turn on the water to the hose, wait for a few moments to let the water fill the rain barrel to the point where the water level is sufficient to slowly drain out of the drain pipe at a constant rate, making it so the level of the water inside the rain barrel is constantly at the level of the drain pipe. And then open the spigot.
Oh, will you look at that?
Cool.
It looks to me like
the physics works. The physics works. The physics works. The physics works. The physics works.
Yes. Yes, it absolutely does. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.